Hello dear students, welcome to EPG Pathshala. I am Navdeep Saini, Assistant Professor, Khalsa College of Education, Ranjit Avenue, Amritsar. Today we will discuss about the topic issues relating to management of continuous professional development of teachers. The main objectives of teaching this topic are to define the concept of professional development, to differentiate between the concepts of training and development, to understand the importance of continuous professional development, to outline the different models of continuous professional development, to understand the advantages of continuous professional development, to identify various factors affecting the outcomes of continuous professional development, and to suggest remedial measures to overcome the obstacles in the way of continuous professional development. First of all, let us understand what we mean by the term continuous professional development. Professional development generally refers to the ongoing learning opportunities available to teachers and other education personnel through their schools and districts. It is continuous in nature as it is a planned and lifelong process whereby teachers try to develop their personal and professional qualities to improve their knowledge, skills, and practice. This helps them to empower themselves and develop their organization as well as their students. It can involve any relevant learning activity, whether formal and structured or informal and self-directed. At this point, it is essential to understand the difference between the terms development and training. As you can infer from the given table, development is different from training on many aspects. Development is a continuous, internal, person-centered and intransitive process based on an internal agenda to bring a personal change, whereas training is a time-bound, budget and trainer-dependent transitive process based on external agenda and often driven by systemic change. These contrasting features of development and training clearly tell that when we talk about the professional development for teachers in particular, it is much more than just training or taking any classes. Rather, it functions as an agent for change in their classroom practice on different levels. Now, the question arises, why is it important to develop yourself continuously in your profession? Well, it sure is important in many ways. Continuous professional development ensures that your capabilities keep pace with the current standards of others in the same field. It ensures that you maintain and enhance the knowledge and skills you need to deliver in a professional service. It makes sure that you and your knowledge stay up to date and aware of the changing trends in the profession. It helps to keep in touch with the latest advancements in the knowledge and technology within the profession. Thus, focused continuous professional development opens you up to new possibilities, new knowledge, and new skill areas. It helps you to stay interested and interesting. So, students, we see how continuous professional development can have a positive impact on teachers' pedagogical content knowledge in the situation where many teachers feel challenged with the teaching of curricular subjects due to lack of previous experience with hands-on activities, lack of content knowledge, and lack of interest to acquire the resources needed to create appropriate learning environments. Now, let us discuss the theoretical perspective of continuous development in the profession of teaching. Although the complexities of the teaching profession require a lifelong learning perspective to adapt to fast changes and evolving constraints or needs, international studies on teachers and their professional development have shown that so far in-service training is considered optional in many countries. Incentives to encourage participation in continuous professional development appear few, and penalties for no participation are rare. According to the national education system, it is the responsibility of schools and local authorities to plan and organize for continuous professional development of the teachers. Next, we will look into the factors affecting the continuous professional development of the teachers. Two theoretical perspectives are usually taken into account in this respect. The first perspective highlights the significance of two types of factors that influence the continuous professional development among teachers. These are the psychological factors such as teacher cognition, their interest and level of motivation, etc. And the organizational factors such as leadership, teacher collaboration and opportunities for teachers learning, etc. In fact, the organizational factors are considered as prerequisites for linking teachers' professional development and school development. The second theoretical perspective often refers to the system theory of change and linking structure and political dimensions of environment at workplace to the professional learning. For effective and lifelong development in the profession, the development and competence can be recorded by following the continuous professional development cycle at least once every 12 months. As it is clear from the given flowchart, the continuous professional development cycle is a four-stage process in which you, number one, assess your learning needs, number two, plan the necessary learning activities to meet the needs you have identified, number three, take action on your planned activities, and finally, evaluate whether your activities have met your learning needs or not. So, we see how this cyclic process helps the teachers to plan, execute, and assess their professional development from time to time. After learning about recording the effectiveness of continuous professional development, let us now explore the various key models of continuous professional development. These are classified according to their capacity for supporting professional autonomy and transformative practice. The first model is the training model. It supports a skill-based technocratic view of teaching, whereby continuous professional development provides teachers with the opportunity to update their skills in order to be able to demonstrate their competence. It is generally delivered to the teacher by an expert, with the agenda determined by the deliverer, and the participant is placed in a passive role. While the training can take place within the institution in which the participant works, it is most commonly delivered off-site and is often subject to criticism about its lack of connection to the current classroom context in which participants work. The next model is the award-bearing model. It emphasizes the completion of award-bearing programs of study, usually but not exclusively validated by universities. These external validation can be viewed as a mark of quality assurance, but equally can be viewed as the exercise of control by the validating or funding bodies. The third model we have down the line is the deficit model. It suggests that the root causes of poor teacher performance are related not only to individual teachers, but also to organizational and management practices. Indeed, to attribute blame to individual teachers and to view continuous professional development as a means of removing individual weaknesses, it suggests that the system itself is not considered as a possible reason for the perceived failure of a teacher to demonstrate the desired competence. Next comes the cascade model. It involves individual teachers who attend training events and then disseminate the information to their colleagues. It is commonly employed in situations where resources are limited and where skills and knowledge are given priority over attitudes and values. The fifth model is the standards-based model. It belittles the notion of teaching as a complex, context-specific political and moral endeavor. Rather, it represents a desire to create a system of teaching and teacher education that can generate and empirically validate connections between each effectiveness and student learning. The next model we have is the coaching or mentoring model. It gives importance to one-to-one relationship between two teachers. The coaching relationship can be collegiate, that is peer coaching, but is probably more likely to be hierarchical, as in, for example, the new induction procedures where every new teacher is guaranteed a supporter who supports the process of continuous professional development and is involved in the assessment of the new teacher's competence against the set standards. Another model that can be followed is the community of practice model. It emphasizes the added value of learning in communities, being the existence of individual knowledge and the combinations of several individuals' knowledge through practice as a powerful site for the creation of new knowledge. The 8th out of 9 proposed models of continuous professional development is the action research model. It allows teachers to ask such critical questions of the political determinants that shape the parameters of the practice. The last model is transformative model. It is the combination of practices and conditions that support a transformative agenda. It involves effective integration of the range of models described earlier, together with a real sense of fairness of issues of power, that is, whose agendas are being addressed through the process. So, students, till now we have learnt about the meaning of continuous professional development, difference between training and development, the importance of continuous professional development, theoretical perspectives to continuous professional development, the continuous professional development cycle, and the various models of continuous professional development. Now, let us focus on the expected outcomes of continuous professional development. When the teachers undergo continuous professional development in their profession, numerous possible types of outcomes of continuous professional development can be expected, such as development and creation of varied learning materials that can be in the form of printed material or even any activities related to the teaching learning process. Secondly, maintaining and updating fact-based information about new policies or schemes related to their field of work. Exhibiting awareness of new ideas and values related to their profession. Reflecting the values and attitudes promoted by continuous professional development in their own values and attitudes. Identifying the effective outcomes in terms of how they feel emotionally, either negative or positive, after the continuous professional development, showing enthusiasm and determination to implement changes, improvisation of knowledge and skills along with the critical thinking in both curricular and pedagogical areas, and the ultimate expected outcome can be its impact on the pupils. These outcomes are non-hierarchical, and it is suggested that teachers have a unique outcome profile from each continuous professional development program with varying amounts of each type of outcome. Some continuous professional development events may result in only one or two of these types of outcome. Indeed, some may only be designed to result in one or two of these type of outcomes, and some may result in a much broader pattern of outcomes. Well, students, how simple and easy to achieve these expected outcomes may seem, let me tell you that such is not the case. There are many obstacles in the way of achieving successful continuous professional development. Understanding the barriers to successful implementation of continuous professional development program in India, it is required to understand strongly some of the external and internal barriers. Let us examine the external barriers first. Firstly, continuous professional development is referred to as a top-down approach. The authorities decide what the teacher educators need to learn. It is something that is done to them. Therefore, most educators resist it and yet go through it with lest they invite negative consequences for themselves. In such a case, it goes against the basic fundamentals of what learning is. Secondly, the approach to training is mostly didactic and prescriptive in nature. It may sound very learned and one may get the feeling of becoming knowledgeable, but its take-home effect and the ability to put it into practice is negligible. Just getting informed of professional development, next is the fault finding and intensive attitude of the stakeholders. Often professional development efforts are clinical in nature for finding faults within the present practices. This will only serve to further disempower the teacher educators. If this is so, it would be like the treatment becoming worse than the disease itself. Another major obstacle is that continuous professional development is treated as a one-time affair. Professional development offered by the central and state government tends to focus on mass training based solutions, often through large-scale cascade models which provide limited scope for need-based and flexible inputs. The skills and experience of the teacher-educators is variable and the lecture method tends to dominate, but more critically, follow-up and school-based support is rare. Following this, maintaining the enthusiasm of personnel implementing the teacher profession development programs is another big problem. Pre-service training at the moment is very theory-based and teachers come out ill-equipped to handle day-to-day classroom reality and receive no encouragement to personally invest in their own development. Add to this the lack of time and incentives for teachers to take it up, and continuous professional development can seem like an insurmountable task. Last but not the least is the problem of low motivational level of teachers, as it is the teacher who decides to undertake the continuous professional development journey. Policies, research material and a supportive environment only supports an individual's choice. The central stakeholder in all continuous professional development programs is therefore always going to be the teacher. In a country where teacher motivation levels are extremely low and where the concept of critical reflection is weak, this is a significant challenge. If we talk about the impact of continuous professional development on students, it enhances teacher knowledge and skills that lead to improved knowledge and skills of classroom teaching, resulting in improved student achievement. If one link is weak or missing, effective student learning cannot be expected. This complex backdrop means that it is essential to work in collaboration with many different stakeholders at national and regional level to change as well as challenge perceptions of continuous professional development. It also means working practically at the ground level and finding ways to support and nurture continuous professional development. Any commitment to change has to acknowledge, embrace, and be continuously solutions focused. The question that arises here is how seriously it is being pursued and with what results. We only need to look at the results to decide what processes needs to be put in place. Anything that we do needs to be goal-oriented. Are present efforts giving us the results in terms of the goals? If they do not, yet we continue with them, we only get the same results. So, if we want different results, we need to change our actions. Therefore, to be transformative, strategic professional development needs to firstly develop the intrapersonal skills among the participants. There is a lot of work that we need to do with our inner side, which consists of our thoughts, beliefs, feelings and emotions, drives, motivations, aspirations, interests, values and so on. When we realize that all our behaviors are caused from the inside, we give away our outside-in explanation. Doing so is totally transformative and empowering. Next, there is need to develop interpersonal or facilitative attitudes and skills. Teaching is as much more or even more about learning to relate to students as it is about imparting knowledge and skills. Therefore, it goes without saying that the teacher-educators' interpersonal skills and attitudes, what we usually refer to as facilitative skills, are crucially important for becoming an effective educator. When students resist learning, whether it is in the primary classes or postgraduate classes, it is often that they are resisting the teacher. If we observe the use of teacher power in the classroom, it is most of the time authoritarian or patronizing, both of which inhibit and suppress the students. Subsequently, there is a need to develop academic and pedagogic competence among the teachers, as learning to teach is a lifelong developmental process and one gradually discovers one's own style through training, learning and through reflection as well as critical inquiry. Furthermore, it is suggested that teachers go digital. Have you wondered if there is a better way to use the all-pervasive technology to involve today's information-rich students rather than just showing them those images on the projector? Teachers must immerse themselves in technology if they want to offer novel and immersive learning methods to students. teachers must learn to create digital content and participate in the vast online knowledge society. They can then help students to do the same responsibly and thoughtfully. Next down the line, teacher development groups should be formed as ideal forums to present successes and learn from the failures. They offer networking opportunities, whether within the school, in the larger community outside, those supported by the educational boards or communities online. Next, it is advised that teachers should seek out professional development opportunities through school programs which recognize that continuous teacher training is essential. The transformation is being felt in many schools as newly empowered teachers reach out and change their classrooms and students. Schools have found that getting their own teachers trained to deliver learning programs reaps more long-term benefits rather than asking for a resource person from the vendor. Teachers enhance their knowledge based from such on-the-job training, and the school benefits with the better integration. Also, the teachers should learn relevant new skills such as communication, collaboration, creativity, and critical thinking that are as vital for teachers as they are for the students. If teachers do not recognize what these skills are and how to integrate them into the school curriculum, how can they teach children? Another suggestion is that teacher may start a portfolio for his every continuous professional development event attended. Besides recording all relevant professional information such as qualifications, employment history, and curriculum vitae, it may contain records and reflective commentaries of continuous professional development activities, plans for development, self-evaluation of professional competencies, and illustrations of skills and abilities. It is a handy resource when talking to mentors or school management, and a record of your personal continuous professional development journey and growth as a teacher. Another thing that teachers may do is to access continuous professional development programs online. The internet offers many structured continuous professional development programs and certifications that can be done at one's own time and pace without missing school, particularly attractive for school management who may hesitate to let teachers go away for continuous professional development programs during the academic year. Lastly, it is suggested that continuous professional development programs should be seen as opportunities to learn from the latest developments, skills and pedagogies, and build network with other professionals. So students, these were some of the suggestive measures that may be taken up to overcome obstacles and provide solution to many problems relating to the continuous professional development of the teachers. Reflecting back on the topic, in the end, I would like to tell you that good teachers always want to be great teachers, but not many teachers are getting the support and training they need to become effective and efficient in the classroom. It needs to be ensured that teachers who are involved in developing their professional capacities are motivated to contribute and to learn from these programs so that they can implement these in the classrooms. Thank you.